Good morning. Welcome to North Mountain Church. Let's worship the Lord together. You can sit if that's your style, but you may find that you just want to stand up and sing with us. So let's worship the Lord this morning together. Oh Lord, my God, you I put my trust. Oh Lord, my God.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name.
Amen. Amen. Wow, you guys can have a seat. We got some 75th anniversary things. God is indeed good. We have been in this location for a long time.
With that, we're going to have three people come and share just a word of testimony. These are people who have been on staff here at the church in the past, or pastors, or one of our missionaries. So we're going to start off with Dan Gabaza, and I'll let him tell you when he was here. And then after Dan, I won't introduce all of you. You can just come up. Then Rick Hoffman will come up. He was here right before me. And then Steve Newkirk, one of our missionaries, will come and share. Okay, Dan?
All right. Thanks. Great to see you. Hey, thanks, Dan. And I'm Dan Gavaza. I was here at Sunny Slope probably the year 68 to 74. So I was still serving when I was 5 years old. Yeah. So thank you for that. Yeah. But anyway, we were here. Roma and her family, my wife Roma back there where I was sitting, and her family attended here at First Baptist of Sunny Slope at that time. And it was my privilege to serve with George Pannell and Dr. Cedric Sears, who served here at the church. One of the things I was just telling Roma a minute ago back there, this auditorium has amazing acoustics. If you like to sing and you like to be with people who are singing, this is a great auditorium for the acoustics, because you can hear everybody around you singing, and it makes us want to sing more. And you did well singing this morning. We were here. Roma and I were married in this church, in this auditorium, December 27th, 1969. Actually, Pastor Pannell had called me up. We were attending, both of us attending Southwestern College. And he had said, hey, I'd like you to come and lead some music and be the music person at this church. And so I was working with his wife down at the old, let's see how many old timers, down at the old ABC bookstore. Anybody remember there are some. The old ABC bookstore down at 1813 East Thomas Road, and I was working with her, and she said, you need to do it, my husband, and go to that church. So that's how we started out here in 1968, and then became, we ministered in the youth. That was back when this building next to us here, where your cafe is, was the entire youth building. It was given over to youth ministry. Back part of it, there were lots of ping pong tables, which were used late into the night every Sunday night. And there's a lot of good memories here. I'm just going to kind of turn it over to the next person, but before I do, I just want to just offer a blessing. One of my favorite verses of Scripture is what you would call, it's one of the many New Testament benedictions. And we say that's a pretty heavy word, but a benediction is really nothing more than a prayer of blessing. And the one I love is the one I'll give you this morning. It says, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's for you today. May the God of hope fill you with all, that's Romans 15:13, in case you were scrambling. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. As you trust in him, no matter what is going on in your world and in your life. What happens when something overflows? Well, if I had a table and I was working on it and I overfilled the coffee cup, what would I be doing? I'd be spilling on everything that was around on the table, right? So the verse really means, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace, no matter what's going on, as you trust in him, so that you spill hope on others around you. And may that be your path as you go forward.
God answers prayer. That's what I gleaned as I reflected on what was going on in the year and a half that I was here. And I wrote it down because it's all quite a bit different things. One of the first things we noticed is that when God put together a team of people, qualified leaders and guidance, who helped the church in a difficult time. Pastor had left, and there's a lot of turbulence. And I see Tom and Joyce and Dawn and others that were here then that became the leadership people. And that was an amazing thing, that they responded when everybody wanted to run. And just a time of amazing. And the leadership team was a group of young, old, male, female, and they worked together in unity towards the purpose. Another grace that the Lord provided was that Don and Kathy Newkirk and Daryl and Doris Preston approached me asking me if I would be open to meeting for weekly prayer. We did that in the office. I don't think hardly any weeks we missed that God was there because of their prayers and faithfulness in that. The Lord guided us in unity and in direction. The leadership team was studying and heading in a direction, and one night Harry Valentine mentioned that Ruby wanted to open a clothes closet food pantry. I was concerned that it could divert us from our task, so I asked Ruby and Harry to meet. As we met and prayed, it seemed like this really was the Lord leading in that direction, and it showed that the church had a social concern. Our music was another area that God displayed his leading, unknown to us. Jeremy, Sean, and Wayne Gillow, along with Jeff Requat, provided the instrumentals and the music. But somewhere along the line, Jeff asked our leadership team if we'd be open to inviting a fellow student and his wife to join the praise team. The leadership was open to that, and Seth and Joel started helping. Little did we know that this was another step towards the Lord drawing the church to Pastor Dan and Barbara. God helped us with attendance, operating funds, unity of leadership team, and support by the congregation. And when we were at the point of considering a pastoral candidate, the Lord brought us with favor to Pastor Dan and Barb. This is God's way. He hears and answers prayer for his glory. This fellowship has stood for 75 years as a tribute to God's love, leading, and your faithfulness. May it continue.
Steve Newkirk here. My wife, Laura, and I have been, I grew up in this church, and we have been serving in Dakar, a city of 3 million people in the westernmost point in all of Africa, in a majority Muslim nation, trying to plant churches there. And in our country, Senegal, there's a Wolof proverb that says, "Ben loho munu tachu," which means one hand cannot clap. It cannot clap. It needs something else to make the sound happen. And I think that's a beautiful thing about God's church. We need one another. It's a family. I grew up in the church here. I was born the year that Dan and Roma were married, and just before that, in 1969, I was introduced to North Mountain Church, and I was rocked in the nursery here, and we actually have that rocking chair. We bought it. It was offered by the youth for $5, and Laura bought it for $10, and we took it to Africa, and we still have that nursery rocking chair in our living room in Africa. It was here that I came. I heard the story of the good news. I heard the stories of God's redemptive purposes for his church, for his people, with the likes of Mrs. Preston in her flannel graph and showing us the flannel graph. And then I see Mrs. Kaufman here with her animated photos and telling us stories that just mesmerized us kids. We were all noisy, and when she started telling the stories, we were just captivated by the stories of the Bible and what God was doing.
And then I see Jim Smith here. He and I went through together growing up through Sunday school here. And remember, his mother and father both taught us. And sometimes it was just the two of us. And sometimes it was Jim. I'd look at him, and it was his turn. And the next, if he answered, it was my turn next. So, but we grew up. And I was here. I came to know the Lord right here. I came down to the front and said yes to Jesus. And right behind me, I made the step of baptism. Said, I want to show the world that God has changed my life and He's brought newness to me. And it was here that I was encouraged. Many pastors along the way said, I see something in you. I want you to be involved in the ministry of the church here. And I remember going to Awana and then serving in Awana, being, you know, giving us a chance to get our hands dirty in ministry. And I see that with the kids nowadays, playing drums, being involved in stuff. It's really neat to see being able to get involved in ministry, because God has served us He's the church is here so that we can serve one another. I love the quote by a scholar, and he said, our walk with God is a group activity. Our walk with God is a group activity, and it really is with the church. We need one another to see our blind spots, to encourage us to share what God is doing to share His word and share what God is doing. So I love the banners that we have up here, because that's the life of the church, to love God, to know God, to love other people, to serve others, and then to change the world. I love the focus of North Mountain Church. And it was here that we were sent out in 1998 to go to Senegal, West Africa. And the church has been supportive of us. They've prayed for us, encouraged us. God has really been good to us. And we love the church so much that we're on the cusp of planting a church in our city of Dakar, because we see the impact that churches make. Churches are still the very best way to reach people and to see them come to know Christ and to grow in Him. And so we are grateful for North Mountain Church for providing a place to know God, to grow in Him, to be sent out, to love people that we haven't even met before, because God's love is like that. He desires for all people to know Christ, for nobody to perish. And so we are grateful for North Mountain's example and their part in that. And so we are very, very grateful. Thank you.
A lot to be thankful for, and to just look to God and just be amazed at all the things He's done over the years. I mean, it seems like Bob just gets better looking as he goes. No. Just had to give him a hard time. Bob told me that before I came, he's been filling in with music since 1989. And so I wasn't sure exactly if that means I just get to fill in after him. That's how we do it around here. But I've been filling in since 2005 now. So one of these days, somebody amazing will come along. No, God is the only one that really matters. If you came to see us this morning or one of these people that's here, you've missed the point. The point really is that God has called each one of us to a special purpose through our life. You've come through this place, but you've gone to other places, and some of you are still here. It's a chapter of our life, where we're at right now, what we're doing right now, what God has called us to. And it's amazing, because I couldn't predict it, and I wouldn't want to change it. God has the best thing for each one of us. He knows the plan for future and for a hope, to help us and not to harm us, that the most people possible would come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and make it to heaven. So I don't know who it is today that's on your heart when I said saving knowledge of Jesus, but why don't we take just a second and pray for them, and then we'll just go back to lifting the Lord up. Lord, we just pray this morning that each of our hearts would reach out to those around us, that we wouldn't just be happy to be in your family and not let that spill over, that that hope that we have would change the lives of the people around us, that those who don't live in hope right now, they just live in this world from day to day, that they would know what it is to know you fully, that they would know what it is to have salvation in you, that the things of this world come and the things of this world go, that you take us from place to place and moment to moment, but that at the end of it all, you receive all the glory, you receive all the praise. And it's by your hand that we do all the good that we do. Lord, we just thank you for your involvement in our lives. Thank you that we get to be part of your master plan. We pray that we can lift you up today, and that joy will just spill over on everybody we meet. In Jesus' name, amen.
your name, bless your name, Jesus. And the deeds of the day and the truth in my way speak of you, speak of you.
Everything.
Lord, won't you all pray with me? Lord, we pray that you would use each of us, that you would receive the glory, that this church here in Sunny Slope would continue to just be a beacon of light to the community, to the communities that we all live in throughout the city and throughout the state. Lord, we just thank you for the training that you've given through this place, the uplifting friendships, the encouragement. We pray that you continue to just do your ministry through us here, that we would each seek after you, and that the people around us would be forever changed because of your love. Lord, just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much, Pastor Dan. And good morning, everybody. It is awesome to see so many familiar faces from the past. In fact, it was a blast from the past when I walked in here and seen so many faces that I actually recognize, which is amazing. And you recognize, many of you recognize my wife and I, and it's just so good to be back here. So, so good. And Pastor Dan, you and your bride have done a wonderful job here. I know God is blessing the ministry, and you've got an amazing spirit that is really impacting the whole fellowship, and it's carrying on really one of the finest traditions or elements of the life of this congregation, and that's that sense of community. And I'm deeply, deeply appreciative of that. Well, guys, it is so good to see you. You know, yesterday I came by. I brought my son with me. I wish he could be here today, but he had to get on a plane this morning. But I brought JJ with me, and we were just wandering around. Pastor Dan met us, kind of took us in every building, and I'm trying to remember what happened in this location and what happened in that one. And it was so filled with precious memories. I remember when there was a pink trailer back behind here. Does anybody remember that pink trailer? You remember that nightmare thing? Anyway, I remember when we broadened out the, I remember when we got the fountain in the back. I'm amazed it still works. Incredible. After all these years, I remember when we covered the building with stucco and we kicked out the sidewalk. But you know what I remember? I remember so many of the fun things that happened in this church. I mean, the pig roast. Somebody came up with this idea. I don't know if it was Bob, who came up with a lot of corny ideas back in the day, but they were great. But we did pig roast, where you just bury a pig. Anyway, it's an ugly picture, but we had some amazing times together. And the chili cook-off, hey, I think I took the bronze on that one. I think I got third place. I never cooked anything in my life other than spaghetti, but I can make a mean chili. I have no idea how I made it. I just threw stuff together, and everybody voted, and I did really good. And I was really proud of myself. That was amazing. But you know, you guys were so good to our kids. You were so good to our children. I can't tell you. I mean, even being in here this morning, I'm not even going to start calling out names, because if I do that, I'm going to leave people out. And I don't want to do that. But it was amazing the way you loved on our kids over and over again. I remember when somebody, I can't remember who was running the children's ministry at the time, but after church, they wanted a meeting with me and with Becky. And that's never a good sign. And they said, we don't know what to do because your kids are out of control. They think they own the place. Well, they kind of do. They live here. Anyway, you guys were so patient and so loving. Our kids loved Awana, and all of you that invested in their lives in Awana was so great. My son remembered falling off the steps out the front here. He was trying to show off and skin himself pretty bad, and he remembered that. And so it was just so good. And man, you were so patient with so many of the corny ideas. I mean, we came up with this silly idea. We wanted a bus ministry. I mean, a big church up the hill here, First Assembly, they had a huge bus ministry back in the day, and we got the idea, you know what, it'd be really cool to have a bus. And we located this bus for $600. And I could still see Bob Brewer driving that thing. I was sitting in there with him. I thought, we're all going to die. This thing is a disaster. I think we bought it for $600, then we immediately had to put $800 worth of tires on it. I mean, just one disaster after another, but so precious. And I think Harry and Daryl Preston and Harry Valentine and Bob were the only ones that were allowed to drive it, I think. Anyway, it was a disaster. I'm glad I never drove that. But you were so patient with all the crazy ideas, but so rich in memories. And you know, we saw so many lives changed, and that was so precious to us. I will never forget the Sunday when I was starting the service. I don't remember if the platform came out this far at the time. Maybe it did, but there was a choir. It was a choir thing in the back here. And I can remember I got up just to begin the service, and everybody was, you know, ready to go, and they were seated, and I just got up to pray. And I looked out, and suddenly the doors swing open in the back. And here's this big guy. And he's dressed in a black t-shirt. He's got long hair. He's got a gold necklace around his neck. And I'm thinking, what's going to happen here? Maybe I had PTSD from my time in Sudan as a missionary. I don't know. But I'm thinking, I don't know if it's going to be good. And we had a deacon at the time. He was the head, I guess he was the head usher. A dear, dear brother. And he had a cane. And he sees this door swing open and this big guy in his black t-shirt that didn't fully cover his belly and this gold chain around his neck. And he came up and he had the cane and he walked up and he greeted this guy so warmly. And I'm watching the whole thing standing up here while this is coming down. And then he brought the guy and he seated him down in the back of the service, at the back of the church. Anyway, I got through the whole service, and then the deacon said, hey, you got to meet the pastor, and brought him up to meet with me. And that guy really gave his life to Jesus. It was amazing. And he told me what he did. He said, I play in bars and stuff, guitar. And I said, well, why don't you play for us? And the next thing you know, he was playing Victory in Jesus and I'll Fly Away. Does anybody remember that? I mean, he sat right up here, and he and I guess it was Don for Junior or something back then, and man, they played a mean version of I'll Fly Away. I mean, I think we all thought we were going to fly away when those guys played it. It was incredible. But there were so many lives changed. So many lives changed. Now, you never knew what was going to happen around here, and I guess that's true even these days. But, I mean, I can remember coming on here and, seeing guys that were just kind of, stuff kept disappearing around here. I mean, it was amazing how much stuff would just disappear, And people breaking in and whatever. It was amazing. And the night that there was this Christian education meeting and a guy came in and said, will you pray for me? And, sure, we'll pray for you. Anyway, I don't think I was in there, but Don Newkirk was, I think. And anyway, they prayed with him, and then the guy got up and left. And next thing you know, they finished the meeting. They go out in the green area out there. And anyway, the guy's naked than anything. And he's taking a shower in the sprinkling system. And I was just, oh, my goodness. Those were the days. But you know what? God has been so faithful. And you guys, your love for us was so precious. And I can't tell you what you mean to me and to Becky. And oh, by the way, Becky, would you stand up? Just this is my dear wife, Becky. You guys might remember her. And Becky has gone on. She's become an author and really an international speaker. She's spoken all over the world. She has a bunch of her books in the back, and if any of you would like that, she's written some tremendous stuff over the years. We actually wrote a book together. Well, I don't know if we'll ever do that again. That was a dumb idea. But anyway. she's got some really good stuff back there, Bible studies and things of that sort. I was thinking about what to share with you today. And I could talk about the faithfulness of God, the goodness of God. I could talk about the way you love one another and how that impacted me. And those are all precious things. But I think what I want to share with you is a lesson that God taught me that I would love to pass on to you. So if you have your Bibles with you, I'm going to invite you to turn with me to the book of Colossians. And, God over the years has really shaped a lot of my thinking about life and about who I am. And I'm on a journey, and I just want to invite you to join the journey with me. And here in Colossians chapter 2, verse 6, the Apostle Paul says these words. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live your lives in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. I want to pick up on that phrase, continue to live your lives in Him. Now you see that phrase, built up in Him. The biggest lesson God ever taught me in my life was that I am in Him and He is in me. And I think, honestly, those are the two most important things that they're true of any believer's life. Anybody who claims to be a follower of Christ, you have Christ living in you and you are in Christ. And that changes absolutely everything. Your entire perspective on life, your outlook on your meaning, your purpose, everything is tied up in those two ideas. You're in Christ and Christ is in you. And Paul challenges us, go deeper into this. Discover, plumb the depths. Learn everything you can about what it means to be in Christ and have Christ in you. Now, there's a few things I've learned about this, and I feel like I'm a novice. I feel like I'm just scratching around on the surface with things I've learned about what it means to be in Christ and to have Christ in me. And I'm going to share a few things that I know, I think I've learned, and then a few things that I don't think I've figured out yet, honestly, okay? So here's what I've learned. I think one of the things I've learned is that because I'm in Christ and Christ is in me, that means that God sees me as holy and beloved, and that I stand before him as blameless because Jesus Christ has washed away my sins and he's washed away yours. If you're a follower of Jesus and you've given your life to Christ and you put your faith and your trust in him, the Father sees you as holy and blameless in his eyes. You're a new creation. You know, over the last few years, I mean, Becky and I pastored churches all up until about 5 years ago, thereabouts, and I was pastoring up in Denver, great church, and I raised up a young guy and mentored him for 4 years and eventually turned the church over to him. And then Becky and I are wondering, well, what does God have for us? Well, we spent the last 4 years or 5 years literally traveling all over the world. Every month we were in another country somewhere in the world. I think we've been in 70 countries, and the idea behind it was we wanted to explore where is it God at work and how do we join him. And honestly, it's been an amazing experience to see the ways in which God is moving in the world today. I mean, I wish I could literally just throw up a map and just walk you from one country to the next to share with you some of the stories of the things we've seen. But one of the most poignant moments for me was when I was meeting with this guy. I'd heard about him, and I heard about his life change, and I thought, I want to meet this guy, so I arranged to meet him in a certain country. Now, I knew that there was a lot of, there was a fatwa, a command, if you will, to kill him because he had become a follower of Jesus. And word leaked that we were supposed to meet, so we wound up having to move the meeting location to a neighboring country. I show up in the hotel where this guy is, and immediately when I look at him, everything about his image, his face, his demeanor was just grace. So I sat down with him and I said, hey, tell me your story, my brother. And he said, well, I was with Al-Qaeda and I was a bomb maker. And he showed me the scars on his faces where bombs had blown up and how he was out to blow up churches and kill Christians. And he was sharing these stories with me, but he wound up getting implicated in a bombing that you would know about, many of you that have been around a while, where a lot of people were killed. And he did not do it, but he got implicated in it, and he thought he was going to go to Guantanamo. And he was listening to the radio one day, and there was a DJ on there who just happened to be a follower of Jesus, and that DJ said that Jesus hears and answers our prayers. So he called up the radio station, and he got a hold of the DJ, and he said, if Jesus hears and answers prayer, will you pray for me? And the DJ said, well, what do you want me to pray for? And he said, well, I got implicated in this bombing, and I didn't do it, and I don't want to go to Guantanamo. Would you pray that, you know, that... And you know what the DJ said to him? The DJ said, well, that's great. Glad to pray for you, but I think you should pray to Jesus yourself. So that night, he said, Jesus, if you do hear and answer prayer. Now, this is an imam. He's the leader in the mosque. Jesus, if you hear and answer prayers, Prophet Jesus, if you hear and answer prayers, would you reveal yourself to me? And that night, as many people in the Muslim world have had, they have visions. And that night, Jesus showed up to him in a vision. And I said, well, was it like a dream? No, no. He said, he showed up to me bright, brilliant, right in front of me. And he said, from now on, you are to be my follower. And that began to change everything in this guy's life. But rather than leaving the mosque, he decided to stay as the imam and teach his people the truth about Jesus. And of course, that just brought down the wrath, you know, on him. However, I got to tell you, God has used him in remarkable ways. I mean, last year, in January, February, March, he was baptizing 350 people every month. The fastest growing movement of the growth of the Church of Jesus Christ in the Muslim world was centered right where he is. And it was brought about in large part because of this miraculous work of God's intervention. And the fact that he didn't leave, he stayed in the mosque and led his people to Jesus Christ. But when I'm meeting with this guy, I'm just so blown away. Talk about a new creation. He just exuded the grace of Christ. And it reminded me of my favorite verse in the Bible, Ephesians 2, verse 10. And that verse says, you are God's creative piece of artwork. You are his poem, created in Christ Jesus unto good works that God ordained beforehand that you should do. But right there's that idea. You're in Christ and you're a beautiful creation. God is reshaping you. Now, I know that to be in Christ means that I stand before God as holy and blameless, but I've also learned that my identity or who I am is not in what I do or in what I've accomplished. My identity is who I am in Christ, and in Christ, who am I? I'm God's beloved. Can you imagine living your life out of that? I mean, so many of us, you know, we say, well, what do? And we take our identity from what we do. I'm a teacher. I'm a plumber. I'm a welder. We take our identity from what we do, but that's not who you are. Who you are is God's beloved child. And wouldn't it be amazing to live your life out of the overflow of that reality? You know, that was a tough lesson for me to learn. Becky and I wound up pastoring a big church somewhere. And anyway, what happened was it turned into outwit, outlast, outplay, survivor of the fittest. And let me tell you, it was the most brutal thing I've ever experienced in my entire life. And I finally just said it, I'm done. I'm not going to be a pastor anymore. And I decided to quit. And I tell you, after I quit, suddenly I started asking the question, who am I? I'd been a pastor since I was 21 years old. I didn't know who I was anymore. It was my identity. And I had to figure out real quick that my identity is not what I do for God. It's not what I've accomplished. It's not my profession. It's not what I own. It's not who I know. My identity is I'm God's beloved child. Now, I know that to be in Christ here, rooted, to live your life in Him, to be rooted and to built up in Him, you got to know your identity. I'm God's beloved. All right? So I know that. I got that part figured out. And here's another thing I had to figure out. If I am in Christ and Christ is in me, then what should be my purpose in life? Do you know how many mission statements Jesus gave us in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? There happen to be 30 of them. And these are the times when Jesus says, the Son of Man came to do this or that, or I have come to do this. And you start looking at him, and what did he say? He said, I came to seek and save lost people, right? He said, I came to serve rather than be served. He said, I came to proclaim the kingdom of God. I came to bring good news to the poor and the powerless, to release the prisoners. You start looking at all that and you say, man, this is what Jesus did. What ought to be the purpose of my life? To join him in his mission. No matter who you are, you don't have to be a pastor, you don't have to be a missionary. Wherever you are right now, your task, your mission in life is simply to join Jesus in his. And what a beautiful opportunity for this church and this community. Simply join Jesus in his mission. Do what he did. Join him in his work. Love people the way he loved people. That's one of the things I loved about this church. You guys were so amazingly accepting of people that were different and people that had all kinds of challenges. And I'll never forget some of those wonderful experiences of watching the way you loved. So I got that figured out. Okay, so now I know the mission of Jesus. But you know, here's something else. If Christ is in me and I'm in Christ, then there ought to be a power to live and love like Jesus. I mean, I look at the Apostle Paul. He says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Paul tapped into that power to live and love. And I truly believe that if you and I have Christ in us, we have the resurrected power of Christ in us. There's no limits on our lives, guys. Can you imagine that? There's no limit on your life. You know, sometimes we have this narrow view. All I can do is this. I can't do much of nothing. You know what? You've got Christ in you. Don't put limits on who you are, how God wants to use you. You know, he wants to use you right where you are. Just take the next step. Just do the next thing. You don't have to have some big, vast plan. Just do the next thing. Love the next person. Reach out for Jesus. I'm trying to figure that out. And honestly, I don't have that all figured out. I don't have any of this all figured out. All I know is this is the grandest adventure of life. To figure out what does this mean? I have Christ in me, and I am lost in him. Can you imagine getting to that point where you're like the Apostle Paul who said in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, what did he say? He said, I've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Can you say that? That's incredible, all right? How about Philippians 1, verse 21, where Paul talks about, For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Can you imagine living on that level, that plane? That is the possibility for you and I. No longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. So my challenge to you as individuals and as a church today is Colossians 2, verse 6. So then, just as you receive Christ as Lord, continue to live your life in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thanksgiving. Let's pray together, shall we? Lord, thank you for this amazing day, the 75th anniversary of this amazing congregation. Thank you, Lord, for the faithfulness, the way you've shown your faithfulness to this body over all these years. And thank you, Lord, for those that have been a part of this story of this church, some of them for decades and decades. Lord, what a blessing it is to be a part of North Mountain. And Father, I pray as we look to the future, I know you've got some great things. Thank you for Pastor Dan and his dear bride and the great work they're doing. But Lord, we look forward to what you're going to do in the future and to be able to celebrate the 100th and then on from there of your faithfulness. But Lord, I pray that you would call each one of us to let our roots grow down deep into Jesus Christ and to build our lives up on him. I pray that every one of us would be on this grand adventure of figuring out what it means to be in Christ and to have Christ in us. I pray that we would look at it like a treasure chest where we're continually going back to that treasure chest and pulling out these beautiful gems of truth that can transform our lives. Lord, thank you for the lives that have been transformed in this room, on this property, and the lives will be transformed in the future because of Christ in us. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
thank you again for being here this morning with us. Don't take off too fast. Stick around, enjoy the food, enjoy the fellowship, and we're just glad to have you here.